For the first half of my life, I did 30 different jobs, and I have too many years of college education because I keep going back for too many different things. In the last 30 years, my full-time job was as a nurse practitioner. My passion was making this farm more productive and more sustainable. Silvopasture is different. The interface between two ecosystems is always more productive than either ecosystem by itself. Each practice enhances the other practice. What I'm doing here is different than most concepts because it's long, straight rows. It's almost farming, and I've seen other examples. So I think randomly scattered forest, which is really thinned down to being pasture with scattered trees, is one extreme, and a fairly structured system like I have is the other extreme. There's probably anything in between that works, and it doesn't mean that you couldn't do part of the farm one way and part of the farm the other. Roughly 32 years ago is when I bought the farm here. The large bottom field, which was terrible for growing anything, I sectioned off about 1/5 of 1 acre and grazed it appropriately under the old standards, turned it in, grazed it down until it was pretty darn short, pull the animals off, and as a proof of concept. And then what happened was it kept regrowing back faster and thicker, and legumes started appearing, and that made a kind of a believer out of me that there's something to this. Currently we have one guard donkey. There are a bunch of sheep out there. They're all Katahdins or Katahdin crosses. And then we have 4 steers. Steers, because we like to eat beef. Originally what we did was we marketed beef direct to the consumer. We also sold it guaranteed for taste, guaranteed for tenderness. If you don't like it after a steak or two, bring the rest of it back for 100% refund, and we never had anybody bring us anything back. And we had wool sheep, very, very high quality wool sheep, but there's no wool market anymore. So we morphed over to hair sheep, which is basically the Katahdins. And then I started looking at numbers and noticed that I was making more dollars per acre off the Katahdins than I was making off the steers, even selling direct to the consumer. When I got into the rotational grazing, it became obvious to me that the animals needed shade. They may do okay without shade, but they'd clearly do better with shade. I first noticed, well over 40 years ago, that in the middle of a drought, the only green grass you can find is what's growing underneath a honey locust tree. It's light, filtered shade, but it's just enough shade that in a drought it makes a big difference. But the story that got me going was the one from University of Kansas a long time ago. 10 acres of irrigated alfalfa bottom, 10 acres of bench up above it. They planted the bench to improve varieties of thornless honey locust trees. By something like year 8, they were raking and baling the pods for more tons of forage per acre than they were getting off the irrigated alfalfa off the bottom. Now, of course, they're planting very high density. They were doing it as a crop purely for the forage. This is for shade, so every pasture will have shade in it, which is the reason for most all the trees out here. But then you always try and get 2 birds for 1 stone, if not 3. So here we're getting shade and nitrogen and improve drought resilience and forage for the animals to eat. The pods are the crop. These are nice pods on this one, but there's not exactly a huge number of them. And a number of the trees this year don't have hardly any pods at all. It's amazing how much year-to-year variance there is. You know, if you had a solid field of honey locusts like this, it may look kind of funny, but it's legume feed for the sheep. They'll keep it raised back quite well. It's obviously been eaten off, eaten off, eaten off, eaten off, eaten off. It's a forage plant, but each year it'll get a little bit bigger because they'll almost eat it down, almost eat it down, almost eat it down. And so I come along here every few years and mow it, and then they'll start the process over again. As long as there's no thorns on it. That's a total different story. The thorns are really, really nasty. They have a toxin on them if the animals step on them and have injuries to the feet, which is a real good reason to keep every thorny tree in the area cut down. There's still no guarantee that, you know, there wouldn't have been pollinated by some pollen from a thorny tree. I like to try at least one experiment every year, sometimes 2 or 3. I would say that 9 out of 10 experiments are failures. Probably half of them are really failures. The 4 of them, they may have broke even, or they really weren't worthwhile doing. But that one that turns out to be something that really, really, really works. You see the shrubby line of stuff out there? You know, I had been kicking this idea around for several years. There are 2 years of growth out there. I figured the first 2 years I wanted to establish real well. So it's not been mowed yet. Last year in a drought year was grazed 3 times. I thought it sounded like a pretty good idea. There's a fair amount of cost and a lot of work to getting it put in. So when I heard about the program, I said, oh, maybe that's what'll be the impetus to get me to actually do it. And it was. I probably would have not done it for at least another year or two or longer if I had not have actually had the cost sharing. But, you know, their cost sharing to help with the defray part of the cost, and then the stimulus that this is when it is and this is the time frames got me going.
Okay.
I did a lot of research looking for different species for shrubs, or forbs more so than trees. The false indigo was a upper higher shrub that a lot of studies showed were 3 to 6 tons per acre of forage. That's supposed to be drought resilience, slowing up the water that floods across here, because the water can run 4 or 5 foot deep through here. That's the legume again, fixes nitrogen. Of course, when we graze it or mow it down flat, we're releasing nitrogen for fertilizing pecan trees. So whenever they're done grazing it, which will be it tomorrow or the following day, I'll brush hog this down flat. I just didn't brush hog it the first 2 years to let it have time to really, really establish. But I want to come out more branchy and more dense, lower forage. We'll see what the cows do. I know the sheep will eat it about yay high, which leaves a shade canopy. I know that you don't normally think of a shrub for shade for an animal, but the sheep would eat up to so high, there'd be a little bit of canopy of leaves on top, and there'd be all the shade it needed. The experimental row out there is 14 feet wide. 2 rows of false indigo with a little bit of a gap on one side, the side that the pecan trees are on. The pecans, because we were trying to look for light shade, the pecan is not quite as light a shade as the honey locust. It's not a legume, but it happens to be our favorite eating nut. That's still in the experimental phase. We got to give another decade to know if it's really worthwhile trying to grow the pecans down in our little frost pocket. These tubes, you see the pecan tree just starting to come out of the top of it, okay? Just slightly higher than the cow can get, the sheep can't get it. The deer can't get it. The deer are probably even worse than the sheep are for eating the trees. So there's all the protection your tree needs. They work absolutely great if you don't leave it on too long. If you leave it on a little bit too long, it tends to be a bit of a disaster because a lot of the trunk strength, it builds up based upon how much it needs to move and how much it does move. It doesn't move very much in here. So the year that this pops out of the top, which is usually the first year, this one didn't last year. So I left the tube on it, but it's popping up now. So, you know, this winter sometime, I'll just pull it off. I've tried lots and lots of different things. The first year to have the grow tube on it works really, really, really well. But then how do you protect the tree after that? This is just what flat works and is easy. Put one T-post next to each little tree. The second year, you pull the tree shelter off. You tie a little bit of support there. It can get too top heavy and break over if you don't do a little bit of support. And then just one insulator, one loop of hot wire around it. And you put the loop wherever it is to keep the animals from reaching it. So this one, that wire is high enough to keep them reaching here. This tree is a little bit smaller and all your greenery is down in here. You just run the wire a little bit lower. Only to the one wire. You don't have to do your verticals for trying to do stabilization. It's cheap, it's easy, it's effective. And then probably 2-3 years from now, the trees will be bigger. We'll just pull it off. I can go use the T-post for something else. If you're putting in an orchard and you want lots and lots of trees, I don't know that I'd use them either. I'm raising animals more than anything else. I'm using animals because that's the fastest, cheapest, most sustainable way to improve the fertility of the ground. The more I improve the fertility, the more animals I can run, the more animals I can run, the more money I can make. I also want to make it easy to do something different. Like I said, my goal is to never put up any hay. But if I have to put up hay, it's still a fairly easy layout to do it. If I had randomly spaced trees, it makes it a whole lot more difficult to put up hay. central access, we have kind of one central lane here, which I treat as a pasture. I don't treat it as a lane. I don't use it as a lane except for equipment access or me walking back and forth or occasionally to move animals if I have to. But it gives you quick, easy access everywhere. That's also where I ran the water line from the river. You know, you need to have water, so you need to have water points. There's almost 4,000 feet of water line here. Basically, every place is within 120-foot hose of a water point, but it's still not quite as convenient in a couple of places as it could be. Now, this is the 100-foot wide, but then this is a header around the next 100-foot wide strip. So like I said, if we were going to hay or mow it, we would basically be able to make very long strips, but we can slice this up a million different ways because there's hot wire all the way around it. One little teeny poly strip or two wires with the sheep and the cows or whatever, and then we can make it whatever size we want to do it. To the left is all our little small fields. The other layout we did, which I would not repeat again, mostly because it's more fencing for less flexibility. I would have done longer strips like this, long as you can possibly get them. Yes, a pasture that's 14 feet wide is a pretty narrow pasture, but it works. But if I did it over again, I'd probably make it 18 feet wide. Still keep two rows of the false indigo. Tried to get something else growing in there between it, didn't work last time. But that would give me enough on each side of the false indigo that I could run a small mower or walk or something else. You saw when the sheep went in down there, they all hugged that one side. That side had the gap because that's where all the pecan trees were planted on. But 14 feet works. I would just make it a little bit wider if I was going to do it over again. Or we're going to replicate it again two paddocks over. Give this a few more years and if it keeps working as good as it is, we may just replicate it over there. It's more like almost traditional agriculture, the way we do it in long rows, except we're planting trees and shrubs and forbs and trying to get synergistic effects and edge interface. I want to still double my organic matter in the soil. I want to get the entire system working smoothly. I want to have it working smoothly enough and well enough that other people are interested in replicating it. I want it to be producing a cash revenue, but then I want to be continuing to improve the soil and making everything basically sustainable on a long-term basis.